So it is a great pleasure and honour that it would be Mary Daly who comes to inaugurate our conversation about Irish history that Anna and Fiona and Ger and Mary and I think will be a contribution to the wider conversation in the community, which is led, of course, by Luxman House, by our friends in NYU who do such brilliant work, by the American Irish Historical Society, by Hofstra, by Columbia, by a great big sort of conversation that's happening in the Hibernians and in the GA and right throughout the community. Because I suppose right now we're getting an opportunity to reflect on our history in a way that we haven't ever had the opportunity to do so before. And Mary comes with a unique perspective on commemorations from her own research and from her membership of the Advisory Board on Commemorations in Ireland. So it is a great, great pleasure and a privilege and an honour to welcome you all here to listen to one of our foremost historians speak to us about the topic she has chosen related to commemoration. And I am delighted to welcome you, Mary. Thank you for being here.
This is actually the first official Royal Irish Academy visit to the United States, as far as I know. We've been in existence since 1785, and we finally managed to get here. There is actually an indirect link, I think, between the United States and the War of Independence and the Academy, because our first president was the Earl of Charlemont, better known as the Volunteer Earl, who took advantage of a little bit of bother at the far side of the Atlantic to set up the first Irish Volunteers and to use them to press for greater independence for the Irish Parliament. Second president, a man called Kirwan, a very distinguished scientist, had affiliations to the United Irishmen, but I think it would be very ill-advised to suggest that that would have been the typical politics and outlook of Academy members and presidents over the past 230 years. But the Academy has played a very, very significant role. Thomas Davis was a member, and the Academy has played a very important role in the preserving and protecting of Ireland's history and culture in so many different ways. Most of you, I suspect, have been in the National Museum. Now, the wonderful gold Arda Chalice, all those wonderful objects that you see in Kildare Street were collected by the Royal Irish Academy in the 19th century. They're really only in Ireland today because the Academy kept them there, and we ran our own museum until the National Museum was set up, and then we transferred them to the National Museum. I think technically we often wanted to we still own them, and we have fantasies about that at times, but I won't go there. And what we have held on to is an extraordinary library, the finest collection of Irish manuscripts in the world, Ireland's oldest book, the Cathaoch, which was a book of Psalms allegedly penned by St. Colin Kill, and so much more. More recently, I think we've made a huge contribution in terms of our history and culture through the 9-volume Dictionary of Irish Biography, which is available online. And I'll talk about more of what we're going to do about this in connection with the connection with 2016, and the 5 volumes of Art and Architecture of Ireland, which we've been launching here in New York, which is quite a remarkable. It documents the art and architecture of Ireland from the early medieval times up to the present day. People know about our writers. This is a bit of the story that has not been told. And we will play a major part in the commemoration programme. Before I begin, I want to really thank Barbara for hosting this. I want to also thank the AOH, the Ladies AOH, and the GAA for their involvement. I think it's very important to reach out to the general communities, and I will say something about the consulate and the wider community in a more historical sense during the course of my talk. Our other link with 1916 in the Academy is that Owen McNeill would have been a distinguished member, and the Council of the Academy, after the rising, voted to expel him from the Academy. One might suggest maybe it was for his countermanding order, but no, not really it was, because he'd been found guilty of high treason. But they held off doing so, and they made amends some years later by electing president in the 1940s. So, you know, it's a forgiving organisation. The 1916 rising is acknowledged. almost universally as the landmark event in the emergence of an independent Ireland. It's the only date on which there is widespread consensus. The Rising transformed the political landscape in Ireland and Ireland's relationship with Britain. There were some Irish nationalists in 1912, 1914 who were more than willing to accept home rule, but for the majority, it was always seen as a stepping stone towards independence. It offered, and I'll come back to home rule again at a later stage, it offered very, very limited self-government. I did put myself a few years ago to say, let's ignore Ulster and home rule, let's look at what would it have been like. And I was horrified by how restrictive it was. It would have given an Irish Parliament much, much less power than the current Scottish Assembly enjoys, about the same as the Welsh Assembly maybe even. It's a really, really limited form of self-government, much less than US states would enjoy vis-a-vis the federal government. But in the years immediately after the Rising and in its aftermath, nationalist ambition in Ireland scaled up to demanding a republic. Now, they never defined what a republic meant, and I think if you'd gone round and interrogated them on the street for a definition, you wouldn't have got very far. But what it did mean was full independence from Britain, as people saw it. Now, I don't need to tell this audience that the USA and Irish America has had a huge role in 1916, in the run-up to it and its aftermath. We'll shortly be commemorating the centenary of the funeral of O'Donovan Rossa, an event that is commonly seen as really pushing momentum behind the Rising. And one thing that we know it did was that it was bring Patrick Pearse to leadership, because it was this graveside oration in Glasnevin at the funeral of O'Donovan Rossa that really propelled Pearse from being just an ordinary member of the Volunteers, a man who, after all, in 1912 was on a Home Rule platform in Sackville Street, now O'Connell Street, speaking in favour of the Third Home Rule Bill, a man known as an educationist. It was his graveside oration at O'Donovan Ross's funeral that brought him to the attention of others, and people said, this is a man who can lead, this is a man who can inspire. John Devoy, longtime US resident, though he was happy to see the Irish Free State emerge in the 1920s, was much more settled here and said he would spend the rest of his life here. But Devoy had a major role, as you all know as well, in the financing of the Rising and efforts to secure arms. The Notre Dame scholar Bob Schmuel, who's been working on this topic recently, believes that five and possibly six of the signatories of the proclamation spent time in the United States. Eamon Cant seems to be the one who definitely wasn't here. The Rising was extensively covered in the New York Times during Easter week 1916, really good coverage. I don't have time to tell you quite how many stories. And quite how they got it so up to date, it's very hard to say. And it's New York. And New York-based writers such as Pori Collum and the American poet Joyce Kilmer, who were responsible for the Rising being branded as a poet's rebellion. They're the first people to use this description and to begin to draw attention to the writings of figures such as MacDonough, Plunkett and Pearse. And despite Woodrow Wilson's refusal to discuss Ireland at the Paris Peace Conference, and that was an embargo that applied to any self-determination that would take anything from the victorious allies in World War I, despite that, the publicity drawn to the War of Independence, drawn to Dáil-Éireann's demands by the US media, and De Valera's quite remarkable campaign in the United States, the more I look at it, many a political campaign today could learn from what Harry Boland and various others did at the time, quite extraordinary. And it was that campaign that really internationalised the Irish question and really put a huge amount of pressure on Britain to open talks with the leaders of the First Dáil. So 1916 matters. It matters in Ireland and it matters among the Irish overseas. Now, in the second half of my talk, I will look at the current wave of commemoration and plans for 2016. I'm going to begin not so much by talking about the Rising, but I'm going to talk about how it was commemorated in the past, because it's quite interesting in many ways. And I will also talk a bit about Irish commemorations of the Great War. You may wonder why I'm bringing the Great War into the analysis, but an awful lot of the 1916 story is best understood in a parallel story with Ireland's commemoration of the Great War. When I started working on it, it's quite interesting. As Barbara mentioned, I am a member of the government's expert advisory group on the decade of commemoration. I'm speaking here as a personal capacity, I hasten to add. The common belief is that the 1916 Rising was celebrated and commemorated very, very widely by the Irish state and its people up to about the early 1970s, and the Great War was ignored. Now, both of these statements are open to very serious question. But before I get into the government action in action, I'm going to shift and look at another aspect of commemoration, the one that I think is much more important, and that's the families, the personal story, not the political. Because when we talk about commemoration, so often you think about parades down a public street. But for many people, commemoration is memory of the dead, memory of somebody they knew who is no longer with them, or memory of events that marked their lives. In other words, survivors. So it's the personal story that I think is very, very important, and I really want to drive that message home. Governments were not the main driver behind the commemorating of either the 1916 Rising or the Great War. That applies away from Ireland as much as in Ireland. It's the families of those who died, the veterans who took part, that really drive so much of the momentum behind commemoration. And unless you understand that, I think a lot of the analysis just falls apart. And here timing is important. The Great War, 1914-18, was arguably the first war where European democracies or proto-democracies fought and large numbers of citizens died. Now, you in the United States experienced that earlier, the US Civil War, where so many, many people died and where so many people were remembered. I mean, you know, I can think, I spent 2 years at Harvard and Memorial Hall and the names there. I could never look at that without being deeply distressed by what I saw there. But in the United States, the Civil War memory happened in a democracy, and ordinary people, ordinary soldiers who died, were remembered in public memorials. If you go back into the history of other wars elsewhere, you may get great generals on them, you may get great princes, you won't get ordinary soldiers remembered in public memorials. It starts in Civil War, it then comes to Europe in around 1918. Bear in mind, by 1914, most European families are literate, they have access to news. Previous war memorials, as I said, commemorated the generals, the great men. Their bodies were often brought home from battlefields hundreds of miles away, buried in memorial tombs. 1914-18, bodies were left to the battlefields, families had no place to grieve. By 1914, ordinary people no longer buried their dead in poor plots where they were anonymous. They needed a tombstone, they needed a memorial. And in Britain, the marking of Armistice Day with 2 minutes silence, the wreaths at the cenotaph, the war memorials, that was all driven not by the political establishment. They didn't want it, they wanted to close it down, and there's some very good recent historical writing on this. It was driven by the families of those who died and by the survivors. It was the ordinary people who did it, it was the ordinary people who bought and wore the poppies, it was the ordinary people who raised the money for the memorials. And what you get in that story is official commemorations lagging behind, responding to public opinion, the veterans, the families of those who died, what they want. Now, why am I telling you all of this? Because I'm really supposed to be talking about 1916. Because a lot of the ritual, a lot of what happens with 1916 derives from, it's inspired by what's happening with the Great War, and many aspects of the 1916 commemorations early years in Ireland are replicating what you get with regard to World War I. Commemorating the Easter Rising began with remembering the dead in a way that all Irish Catholics at the time did. Months mind masses in many Dublin churches held for the 14 who were executed in Kilmainham. They were carefully staggered so that you could attend every one of them. They were very, very well attended. Todd Andrews, in his memoirs, writes about his father, who would not have been a supporter of the Rising, but himself and his father felt he should attend the Months mind mass in Farnham Church for Patrick and Willie Pierce. And he went there and the church was absolutely jammed and they were amazed. And Todd himself went to almost all the other Months mind masses in a variety of city centre churches over the coming weeks. And those Months mind masses turned into spontaneous demonstrations, supporters jeering at the Dublin Metropolitan Police. The other thing you get, and we have a very good collection in an online, you can see them in, there's an online collection on the UCD on the UCD a digital library, if you go into it, and lots of memorial cards, memorial books about the victims, which were very, very widely sold. anniversary masses the next year, huge attendance at them. These personal rituals were at the core of the 1916 commemoration for many years. Now, that said, political funerals are nothing new in Ireland. We've mentioned O'Donovan Rossa. We could start with McManus, which had, of course, its New York leg as well as the legs in Ireland. I mean, McManus was brought from California, as you know, to New York and eventually to Dublin. And you have Manchester Martyrs, where there were no, where empty coffins were paraded, a ritual that was replicated in the early 70s after Bloody Sunday throughout the Kerry towns. Quite fascinating. You can see the unconscious memory. And I don't know whether the people who did it in Kerry after Bloody Sunday in the 70s knew that they were replicating what happened to the Manchester Martyrs, but that's what they were doing. So there's a huge popular tradition of this that must be captured, that is a large part of the story that goes way beyond what a government or governments will do. But let me move on to the political and see the contrast. Easter Rising was widely recognised as the most important event in Irish history. Every Irish government up to 1969 had veterans of 1916 Rising among its members. But despite all that, bizarrely, the Rising was not very actively commemorated by the independent Irish state, probably, I think, because they were so traumatised by the memories of the Civil War. It's the only thing that makes sense to me. Men who had fought side by side, divided over the Civil War, and because of that, dealing with 1916 became much more problematic. The government in the 1920s did attend the memorial mass at Arbour Hill for the 14 signatories who were buried there. That was the first a 1916 commemoration where government ministers can be seen. It remains the longest continuing official commemoration of the 1916 Rising. But despite the military ceremonial, that was essentially a private affair. Indeed, those graves were not accessible to the public for many years. The ceremony was dominated by the relatives, and until very recently, the tradition was that the families led the procession from the church directly behind the president, so the Taoiseach would be taking up the rear, Council of State, ministers et al., just like a typical Irish funeral. That changed a few years ago, and I got berated in multiple places around Dublin by people who knew I was on the commemoration committee to tell me, and it was only when I began to listen to these complaints coming at me, you know, you'd be walking out from a lecture and somebody says, you're on the committee, what have they done about Arbour Hill Mass? And great distress caused to people that suddenly the government of the and senior dignitaries were coming out of the church at Arbour Hill ahead of the relatives, because this is still seen as a family memorial mass by many of them. But there was no government Easter Sunday commemoration until 1935, 19 years after the rebellion and more than a decade after the Irish Free State was established. There were always Easter Sunday events. Different groups would have their mass, different groups would go to the Republican plot, different groups would march past the GPO, maybe have a minute's silence. There'd be a variety of things, but no government event. And in the aftermath of the Civil War, there appears to be little appetite for formally remembering Easter 1916. Cosgrave offered the ruined GPO to the Archbishop of Dublin as the site for a Catholic cathedral. He turned it down. A new plan for the city planned to transform the GPO into a new city hall. When the GPO was being rebuilt in the late 20s, there was no apparent interest in incorporating some form of 1916 memorial. It would have been very easy to take the ruin and say, we won't turn it all back into a post office. We'll make this bit of 1916 memorial. It wasn't done. By the early 1920s, Republicans were holding Easter Sunday commemorations in very, very many parts of Ireland. You'd have a speech, probably in the centre of town, or at a site that was connected with some Republican leader. My old castle in Galway was connected with Liam Mellow, so they'd do it there. And then in 1925, and this is quite an important date, in 1925, Sinn Féin announced that they decided to hold a day of national commemoration in honour of those who have died for Ireland, and they had chosen Easter Sunday for the celebration. So Easter Sunday becomes the days for Republicans and families to remember all who died, whether in Easter 1916, War of Independence, or Irish Civil War on the Republican side. Note, the Risings happened on a Monday. It should have happened, but for Owen McNeill, it would have happened on Sunday. But it happened on a Monday. But Sunday was the date chosen, partly, probably in my estimation, I have no proof of this, to suit the rhythms of rural Ireland, provincial Ireland, because nobody had bank holidays in those days, except the bankers, I suppose. And people took Sundays off. The standard ritual was a mass, parade to a graveside of men killed during the Civil War, War of Independence, or later Republican events. In County Monaghan, where I grew up, the memorial, the commemoration for Fergal O'Hanlon, who died in a raid of Rookburgh Barracks on New Year's Eve in the 1950s, that was Easter Sunday. They could easily have done it on New Year's Eve, New Year's Day. But so, in other words, Easter Sunday becomes the day of commemoration for all who died for Ireland, particularly from a Republican tradition. And it becomes the Republican Armistice Day, the equivalent of the Armistice Sunday or the 11th of November. Other Republican elements are also, in my mind, I think replicating what they're seeing for World War I, the Easter Lily rather than the poppy, the National Graves Association to care for the graves of veterans, rather like the War Graves Association, which is also spreading at the time. So what you have by the late 20s is a commemorative framework, but it's not a government commemorative framework, it's the preserve of Republicans. The election of Fianna Fáil to government, which brings a large part of the anti-treaty Sinn Féin into office, doesn't change this story. There's no public government ceremony to commemorate the Easter Rising, except for the Arbor Hill Mass, until 1935, when there was a parade past the GPO on Easter Sunday, and the unveiling of the Cúchulainn statue in the GPO as a 1916 memorial. De Valera organised the 1935 commemoration to reclaim Easter 1916 for the state. It had been the preserve of the Republican movement, he reclaimed it for the state. And there's very clear parallels with Bertie Ahern's decision to restore the Easter Sunday ceremony in 2006, which I always find interesting. As for the Great War, there is substantial evidence of well-attended public commemorations of the ending of the Great War, of the Armistice, in Dublin, Cork, many provincial towns. I could give you a long description of one in Ennis in 1933, if I had time. But it was widely commemorated throughout provincial Ireland well into the 1930s. Yes, by the 1930s, some of those parades were becoming acrimonious, subject to attack by Republicans. The Dublin Armistice Day Parade was moved to the Phoenix Park, where it became easier to control those attacks. But also in the 1930s, parades in provincial towns for 1916 were subject to attack by the Blue Shirts. So what I'm saying is that both are contested in a certain way, both are seen as controversial by sections of Irish society. And in terms of public memorials, the Great War fares much better than 1916 does in the first 20 years of the new state. The government allocated £50,000, which is a very large sum of money, for the memorial garden designed by Lutyen, which is at Island Bridge. The labourers hired to work in this were veterans of either the Great War or the War of Independence. There's a lovely parallel, 50% from one and 50% from the other. By comparison, the only 1916 memorial purchased by the state pre-1939 is the Oliver Shepherd statue of Cúchulainn, but it was sculpted in 1912. In other words, it wasn't done for the Rising. Somebody said, we need a memorial fast. Yeah, that one will do. How much is it? Or something to that effect. So, you know. The Island Bridge Memorial Gardens was scheduled to open in 1939. De Valera gave a commitment to attend the official ceremony. He didn't attend, there was no official ceremony, because World War II had broken out and the whole thing was put on hold. World War II is fundamental to what happened to commemorations of the Great War in Ireland. You couldn't hold a parade or a public event to mark the end of World War I, celebrating, if you like, the Allied, the British side, in a neutral Ireland during the Second World War. All the commemorations were treated indoors, many to churches. But there's no conspiracy, there's no mystery there. It makes absolute common sense in any modern democracy, in any country trying to preserve its neutrality. There's no conspiracy. After 1945 in Britain, the memories of World War I recede quite sharply in the face of the much more recent war. A Remembrance Sunday becomes a kind of composite national day of remembrance, and World War I really does fade into the background. So it's not just in Ireland that it fades into the background, it faded there as well because it had been superseded. As for 1916, the public GPO ceremony doesn't become an annual event after 1935. They do one in 35, but most years the only formal government involvement is Arbor Hill. Individual ministers might attend a Dublin Old IRA or similar event. They went as veterans, not in a personal capacity, not as ministers. There was a very big ceremony in 1941, the 25th anniversary, large military parade. This was also politically very advantageous. The message of that parade was Ireland is neutral, but Ireland is armed, and Ireland will repel all invaders. But that doesn't start an annual state commemoration. In 1947, just to pick a year at random, De Valera goes to Arbor Hill, lays a wreath. That's the sum total of official ceremonies. Ireland becomes a republic on Easter Monday 1949, which is a deliberate link with the 1916 rising. And that is the first time the pro-treaty Fine Gael Commonweal politicians participate in a public official ceremony to mark the Easter Rising, because there's an inter-party government. But the event was really to mark the Republic. Their attendance doesn't become an annual event. Some show up later years, probably the Minister for Defence. A lot of them don't. John A. Costello, the Taoiseach, was conspicuously absent from the viewing stand until 1955. He was of the 1916 generation, but he didn't take part in it and probably would not necessarily have been in sympathy with it. And then you get this weird story in the early 50s. For several years, the commemoration alternates between Easter Sunday and Easter Monday, depending on who's in office. Inter-party government on Easter Monday, it's like Lanigan's Ball, Fianna Fáil on Easter Sunday. And, you know, as somebody who tracked it through the newspapers, it gets quite confusing at times. The other thing that happens in the 1950s is that the Easter parade, which finally settles on the Sunday, is also transformed to the official opening of An Tuathail, a national festival which was devised to bring Irish emigrants back to Ireland for a visit, with lots of associated events. When the gathering got launched a few years ago, I announced the gathering was An Tuathail for slow learners, and it was in very many ways. In the 1950s, the other strand, so the parade becomes very confused. You know, it's sending that message out as well, on logic of An Tuathail, we're celebrating the anniversary of the 1916 Rising. The other strand that comes into it very much in the 1950s is the All-Ireland anti-partition campaign. In 1955, for example, and these are different kinds of parades, it was a themed parade, and the theme was the 32 counties. And the parade was led by Ulster, and there were these kind of figures. They look straight out of Alice in Wonderland, actually, dressed in notional costumes of the fictional Knights of the Red Branch. So that's the Easter Sunday parade. So there isn't a fixed model for a 1916 commemoration at official level. And I think it's important to understand that, because there is a mindset out there that said there was something that happened every year until 1972 and then it was stopped. There wasn't. I'm not going to take you through year by year, you'll be relieved to hear. I want to move on to the Golden Jubilee in 1966. And the first point to make is it was not typical. It was unprecedented, and it was seen at the time as unprecedented. It was a big celebration. It was an opportunity to celebrate the achievements of an independent Irish state. It looked a lot to the future. Very, very much to the future. And it was looking to the future at a time when the economy and the population were both expanding. My favourite quote, which I'm probably overusing by now, is Sean Lamass in 1966, that the true descendant of the Irish volunteer in the GPO will be the student in the regional technical college. They hadn't been built yet, but you know, in other words, instead of dying for Ireland, they will now develop technological skills and work hard for Ireland to build a better Ireland. But it does sum up a different mindset at the time. As I said, the emphasis was on the economy, huge emphasis on educational opportunity, lots of educational scholarships being given out. One admirable company, I think it might have been Jacob's Biscuits, gave scholarships to girls and not to boys, and it was quite interesting. Huge emphasis on modernity. There was a documentary made which the Irish government wanted to circulate around to all the international TV companies, and they did show quite a good short history of 1916 and, you know, using a lot of the contemporary photography. But then they determined there had to be a contemporary dimension, so they added images of power stations, the Donnybrook bus garage, the RT studios, a factory in Finglas and everything else. Apparently this completely confused the foreign TV companies, and if they showed it, that bit just got cut. And we can understand why the director was really very unhappy to having to add it. But the message is they were looking at least as much into the future as to the past. One noteworthy feature in 1966 is really active involvement of all the major churches. Special ceremonies, all Church of Ireland cathedrals in the Republic, services of Thanksgiving, Presbyterians, Jewish community. Special lecture series held by the Methodist community to look at Ireland since 1916. But all these ceremonies reinforce the sense that I got in 1966, which was of a very partitionist celebration. The churches were careful to ensure that the ceremonies didn't include their co-religious in Northern Ireland. And sadly, the more pluralist sense was somewhat spoiled when Don Charles McQuaid, the Archbishop of Dublin, refused to agree to a multi-faith blessing at the opening of the Garden of Remembrance. But in Finglas, which is to the north of the city, the Church of Ireland and Catholic clergy organised their joint commemoration ceremony for the Easter Rising. The other thing about 66 is that the relationship with Britain was very good at the time. Despite the fact that a bomb was found outside the home of the British military attaché, they made almost no fuss about it. British coverage of 1916 is quite remarkably positive. When I read the Daily Express and their enthusiasm for the rebels, I thought I wasn't feeling too well. There was a very large mass rally in Trafalgar Square, addressed by Rory Brewer and Maura Brewer, who would have been the daughter, of course, of the late Maura Brewer, the daughter of Terence McSweeney. Huge crowd there. Sporting and cultural events among the Irish communities in Britain. Really good involvement. Probably the first time, really, the Irish in Britain had got engaged in something like this. United States was trickier in 66. And the coverage of the New York Times and Washington Post, which was much less positive than the coverage of British media. It's quite clear in terms of the New York Times particularly that some people in Northern Ireland had got their ear, because they produced some of the stories byline as Belfast, and you get all things concerned about the security threats during the Jubilee, reports of alleged bombs and incidents, some of which, I don't know whether they happened, they don't even feature in the guard, the confidential security log of the events at the time. So I just wondered, did they happen at all? But it was a strange, strange coverage, very contrasting to the very positive coverage in 1960, very sympathetic coverage in 1916. In the United States, some of the Irish diplomatic staff found themselves in a rather difficult position, because the Irish American organisations were very focused on the ending of partition, and they were less in tune with Lamassa's messages of modernising the economy. So the US Consul General, Barbara's predecessor in New York, attended a mass on Easter Sunday in the Paulist Church of St. John the Apostle to mark the anniversary of the Rising. But as he explained back to Dublin, he absented himself from the parade organised by the Associated Irish Societies and also from a dinner organised by the AOH, because there were veterans of the 1956-62 border campaign being given a prominent role in it, and that would have been similar to other consulates. By the 1960s, and I've written about this elsewhere in print, the relationship between the Irish consulates and the Irish Embassy in the United States and Irish American groups was not, such as the County Association, was not good. It wasn't close. The Lamassa agenda was economic development, building closer relations, and building closer relations with the Northern Ireland government. Also building closer relationships in terms of attracting US investment with elite US business interests. And frankly, if you're trying to get at this stage to the elite US business interests, Irish Americans were not prominent in those circles. Things are very different today. There's a huge prominence of Irish Americans, but they weren't there at that stage. So there was a real distancing between Irish America and the embassies, and the same applied people in distress and other things. More importantly, and Frank Aiken's independent stance at the United Nations, prepared to discuss the admission of communist China, also, which caused a lot of trouble to Cardinal Spellman here, also was a distancing element between Irish America and the Irish government. More equally importantly, and I think quite remarkably, again, it's something I've been horrified by. Irish governments gave almost no money to the consulates to meet or support Irish communities overseas. So Irish people who came into distress would have had to rely on the parish, on the county associations, on local communities to have for relief. And there's a rather sad file from one US-based consul general, I can't remember which one, it might be Boston, the 1960s, saying he dreaded St. Patrick's Day because he had nothing to offer the Irish community by way of hospitality. He felt embarrassed by it because he felt he was going out with one arm as long as another. And he said, surely can they not do something to change it? I hope things have changed for the better, Barbara.
I couldn't.
But there's certainly much more engagement, that much I know. The Irish consulates in 1966 did hold quite a series of events. A lot of them focused on the culture. The writers particularly was the big thing, Boston in particular. And there were large numbers of Irish Americans who travelled to Dublin for the Jubilee. The Boston Era Society marched into the parade, and they really broke, you know, they probably had a first because say one of the people carrying their banner was a woman called Bernadine Trudden, who kept a diary. Women just didn't march carrying banners and parades in Ireland in 1966, and she was determined to be one of the banner bearers. AOH and the New York National Graves Association chartered special flights. Jerome Connor's statue of Robert Emmett was unveiled on Easter Sunday 1966 outside the Irish Embassy in Washington. Purely by coincidence, the British Embassy unveiled a statue of Churchill outside their embassy on the same day, about a mile away. It's pure coincidence. And a replica of the Emmett statue was brought by Irish Americans to Ireland and presented to De Valera, where, you know, the AOH delegation was led by Kilkenny-born Judge Comerford, a veteran Republican, and he described a really jam-packed programme that went to all the official events, you know, GPO, Easter Sunday, Garden Remembrance, so on, and they had their own personal wreath-laying ceremony in Arbor Hill. But the message back in his coverage was very much in the message of recovering Ulster, ending partition. 1966 has retrospectively been seen as a cause of the Troubles, and I meet this all the time, and I'm sick of it. It's also seen as glamorising blood sacrifice, legitimising an undemocratic rising, and all the rest. First of all, let's take what government ministers did. Most speeches focused on contemporary Ireland, on the future. If you look at the leadership and the pageants and everything, they're presented as educators, poets, trade unionists, writers, scholars. They're visionary, idealistic men. Very little for women, I'm afraid, at the time, if they weren't called Constance Markovics. But the message is coming through. I mean, I remember once saying that it was almost a bloodless rising. The whole focus and the way the people were presented was their ideas, their mindset, other things that they did beyond the violent part. Very little attention paid to casualties, whether civilian or military. The argument that the rather ham-fisted series that ran on television, Insurrection, single-handedly ignited militant republicanism is just simply crazy for all kinds of arguments. First of all, when we showed clips of it in the Humanities Institute in UCD, everybody fell around laughing at how ham-fisted it was. But apart from that, very few people in Northern Ireland could see Televisión, as was then called, in 1966. There's no way they could have got the messages from the ceremonies. They couldn't have seen the stuff. They had no access to it. But as Margaret O'Callaghan has shown, the commemoration does play a part in the very unstable Northern Ireland story. The commemoration did emphasise the contrast between a very confident, independent Irish state and beleaguered Northern nationalists who felt that they were increasingly being ignored by their Southern confreres. In other words, by cozying up to Terence O'Neill, the Northern Ireland Prime Minister, you are seen as abandoning Northern nationalists. And there is an element of truth in that. So in other words, the gulf between the two was increased, and there was a sense that Northern Ireland had to act alone, Ulster nationalists had to act alone. As for Terence O'Neill, he was a ditherer. And as part of this, he initially permitted a major 1916 commemoration to be held in the Ulster Hall, which was the seat of some of Carson's greatest rallies. Then he withdrew permission. He did permit a major rally and parade in Casement Park a week after Easter Sunday. Then he sealed the border, created a whole security fuss. And by doing this, he alienated every side, is the best way to put it. This is also a time when Protestant paramilitary sectarianism is on the rise. 1966, summer sees the murder of several Catholics in Belfast simply because they're Catholics. The Protestant paramilitaries also bombed the reservoir there, Silent Valley, which was blamed on the IRA. Ian Paisley was jailed that summer for some of for sowing seeds of militant disaffection. So the Jubilee adds certain fuel to what is an already volatile environment, but the emphasis I would put is that it was already a volatile environment which was cranking up. If you look at the history of commemorations of the Rising in terms of the on-again, off-again story that I've told you, the decision to cancel the GPO parade in 1972 is less anomalous than it might appear. There has actually been a parade on Easter Sunday past the GPO, a government parade, military parade, on less than half of the years since the Rising. That is the fact. Those who kept the memory of 1916 alive most vigorously were, as I've said, the relatives, the veterans, and various Republican groups. One of the surprises for the government in 66 when they determined to hold parades in various provincial towns was the discovery, yeah, they already had a parade, and they'd had a parade for decades, but various groups were organising them, so there was a huge amount of negotiation that you didn't have clashing parades. The memory of 1916 and what we have by way of relics of 1916 is there primarily because of the families and the veterans. The 1916 exhibition in the National Museum, which is still there in a more modern form, reopened in 2006, was entirely, that 1916 exhibition was collected by descendants of those who fought and died. And they put pressure on a very, very reluctant museum, which was much more interested in ancient archaeological remains, to hold a temporary display in 1932, which coincided with the Eucharistic Congress. It was supposed to be there for 6 weeks for the Eucharistic Congress, but the numbers piled in, and it was so popular that they could not close it down. They didn't want it, but they couldn't close it down. Nevertheless, one curator, Hayes McCoy, complained that the exhibition was looked on as a memorial to the dead rather than an ordinary museum collection, whatever that is, and he refused to accept a lock of Thomas Ashe's hair. Thomas Ashe died on hunger strike. He was the man who fought in Ashbourne. He died on hunger strike a year later. De Valera donated personal items to it. He encouraged others to do the same. He did not give it the state's blessing. As for Arbor Hill, where 14 of the 16 leaders who were executed are buried, it didn't become a formal memorial until the 1950s. It's only then that the memorial wall and everything you see today was done by the Office of Public Works. Until then, it was very hard for the public to get access. As for the Garden of Remembrance, that was first mooted in the 1930s. The site in the Rotunda Gardens is where those who fought in the Rising were held after the surrender. It's also beside the assembly rooms where the second Irish Volunteers, the Owen McNeill Irish Volunteers, were formed. Work was just about completed on the Garden of Remembrance in time for the 50th anniversary in 1966. But the Ushing Kelly statue, the Children of Lure, wasn't unveiled for 7 years afterwards. There'd been a heated debate as to what kind of statue, would they have a volunteer or would they have something more abstract. And as for Kilmainham Jail, which is now one of Dublin's greatest tourist attractions, it survives thanks to the determination of veterans that it should survive. Now, De Valera encouraged the veterans to support it, but the work was largely done by voluntary effort, and it was voluntary momentum that made it there. So if you're going to measure government's commitment to a historical event by their erection of official memorials, 1916 barely features. Many memorials were unveiled in 1966, but they're almost all local committees' voluntary efforts. In fact, a lot of them used the Golden Jubilee to do something that they had great intentions of doing for at least 55 years before that, and they did use it for fundraising and get it done. When Margaret Cannon and I first set out to research the Golden Jubilee of the 1916 Rising, which was a project funded by the Irish Research Council as part of the North-South Good Friday Agreement Initiative, we wrote a proposal which said we would contrast the commemoration of the 1916 Jubilee and the commemoration of the Golden Jubilee of the Somme. Well, we didn't do it, I must now admit. And we didn't do it because there was so little to say about the Somme that there would have been blank pages everywhere. There was no official commemoration in Northern Ireland of the Golden Jubilee of the Somme in 1966. Terence O'Neill went to France at some stage and something happened, but it wasn't commemorated. By the 1960s, however, indeed from the 1920s, the memory of the Somme had been completely appropriated by the Orange Order and Ulster Unionism. The fact that it happened on the 1st of July, which was the old date for the Battle of the Boyne, seemed symbolic to them. The Ulster Catholics, the many Ulster Catholics who fought there, the first to die was a Catholic, were written out of the story. The non-Ulster Irishmen who fought were written out of the story. By 1969, however, the Somme is on the up again, and by 1966, Philip Orr, who's the historian of this, claims that the exploits of the Ulster men of the Somme had been occluded by the Irish memory of the war with Nazism. The Somme story was pretty well dead. It does, however, revive after 69 as a story that can be told to give an identity narrative to unionism. Similarly, the Great War was largely absent in 1966. Lammas makes some references to it in his speeches. Many of the veterans would have been alive. It was very muted in Britain as well. That's the other side to it. It's there as a story of poets, trenches and various things, but it's a story that's dying and been forgotten. In Australia in the 1970s, the Gallipoli commemoration almost disappeared. People were convinced it was coming to an end. So I'm just putting on record that forgetting and genuinely receding from memory is part of the commemoration narrative in many countries, not just in Ireland. But let me move on post 1969. I'm not going to take it in great detail. The first thing to note is that, in my opinion, the decision to cancel the GPO parade at Easter 1972 is understandable in light of the tensions after Bloody Sunday, but it was ill-advised. Worse still was the failure to reinstate that parade until 2006. The vacuum leaves 1916 as the preserve of the IRA, provisional and official, and it also marginalises what was a landmark event in Ireland's history. But the absence of the parade also reflected a serious hesitancy about the 1916 Rising and its possible links with the conflict in Northern Ireland. And I'll focus in more detail on that in a moment when I deal with the events of that decade. Much attention has focused on the neglect, particularly in the 1970s and 80s, of the war memorial at Island Bridge. And you can argue that, but I would argue that the neglect applied to both 1916 and the Great War. I personally can recall being in the Garden of Remembrance, I think it was probably in the 1990s, when it was a very sorry place with weeds coming up through the paving stones, littering the pool and everything. So neglect was found in two very important sites of memory at the time. So I think there was genuine neglect, but the neglect was a balanced neglect. It was overdue and it needed to be remedied. It has been remedied significantly over the past 20 odd years, almost 20 years. The current decade of centenaries, decade of commemorations, depending on what you call it, reflects a new Ireland. And again, there are two stories in it, and one of the key ones is political, but there's also a personal one that I'll come to. The landmark events behind the change are obviously the Good Friday Agreement and the amendment of Articles 2 and 3 of the Constitution to involve a broader set of historical traditions. You also get the erection of the Peace Tower at Messine, which was opened by President Mary McAleese and Queen Elizabeth II on 11th of November 1998, the date again quite significant after the Good Friday Agreement. But also worth noting that this was a personal crusade by two men, Glenn Barr, a unionist, and Paddy Hart, very much a nationalist. You also have the state visit of Queen Elizabeth to Ireland, where I had the privilege actually of being a part of the commentary team in RTE. I was the person who had to contextualise the Garden of Remembrance scene, which I think was by far the most moving scene of the lot. You had the state visit a year ago by President Higgins to England, which was again quite remarkable in many ways. So what are we left with now? The first thing to note is it's no longer controversial to acknowledge or to commemorate Ireland's role in World War I. The Taoiseach has attended Armistice Day Sunday celebrations in Enniskillen. President Higgins attended the ceremonies in Belgium marking the beginning of the war, which was covered live on television and watched very widely, except in my own household, where I was, because I was on television and none of the family saw me until they watched it later. But Ireland's commemoration in World War, participation in World War I is no longer controversial, and the Irish ambassador is again laying a reed at the cenotaph. The last time they did it would have been 1948, as far as I can see. Many Irish people, and I want to move to the people a bit, many Irish families have researched their family members who fought in the war. They've travelled to Flanders. It's quite common to meet somebody who says, oh, I'm just back from a trip to Flanders. My great-great uncle or my great-grandfather's cousin did something. We wanted to visit his grave or something like that. So there's a lot of that going on. It's also going on with regard to 1916, because with the release of the Bureau of Military History files and the military pensions files, and they're available online, you can check them free. If people can find the stories of relatives, people from their own area, we're getting into the stories of the ordinary men and women who took part at the time. The appetite for connection with 1916 participants or with the Great War knows no end. And the family stories are interesting because they're creating a much more complex picture. Families where some fought in the Great War, others in the War of Independence, some who fought sequentially in both. Tom Barry and Dan Breen are two names that come to mind, World War I veterans and also veterans of the War of Independence, and there are many, many others. There is the reintegration of Catholics into the World War I story. Also, I hope a better understanding of their motivation, because so many of the Irish have fought in it because the Irish did fight in the British Army over many generations because they got jobs there. And that is one of the motives. Others went to bring home rule. They went for various reasons. As for the commemoration programme, in 1912, the government announced the start of a decade of commemorations, or as others term it, a decade of centenaries. The intent was to be inclusive, and at an early stage we came up with our version of that from the committee, which was that it would be measured and reflective. It would be informed by full acknowledgement of the complexity of historical events and their legacy, of the multiple readings of history and the multiple identities and traditions which are part of the Irish historical experience. Some of the early versions of inclusiveness seemed to, in people's minds, mean you'd have Orange men marching past the GPO on Easter Sunday. Not on my watch, I hasten to add. My view is what you need is to allow space for those who want to mark a World War I to do so in a dignified and respectful manner, but it's not mandatory for everybody to join that. Those who want to mark Easter Sunday to do so in a dignified and respectful manner, it doesn't mean that everybody has to join in that. So I think it's a matter of, in other words, multiplicity, diversity of commemorations done in a respectful manner, I think has to be the theme. Chronology is important because a lot of people observing the programme of commemoration seem to think it was tilted much more towards World War I and the parliamentary story and ignoring 1916. That's actually what happens if you go 1912, 2012, 1913, 2013, 1914, 2014, because you start with the Third Home Rule Bill, you move on through other events like that. And the focus on the Home Rule Bill and the focus on the Home brought a new interest in the Irish Parliamentary Party, and particularly its leader, John Redmond. Now, some people, notably former Taoiseach John Bruton or Redmond's biographer Dermot McMillady, have claimed very volubly that Ireland could have secured home rule, moved peacefully from home rule to full independence. In other words, that 1916 was both unnecessary, and in fact worse, it was damaging and divisive. Now, that's very, very much a minority opinion. You'll find very few historians that will hold that opinion. Bluntly, Britain introduced the Third Home Rule Bill in 1912 because they had no other alternative if the Liberals were to stay in office. They did it without any. The Irish Party had the balance of power. Many people in the British establishment regarded the bill and Ireland's electoral influence as illegitimate. You're a bit far from it, but I've been watching the more recent British general election with acute fascination, and some of the debate about maybe the Scottish Nationalists would have the balance of power in Westminster, and this was seen as an absolute outrage, anomaly. It would be seen as unconstitutional, betrayal of everything. And I kept saying, I've heard this all before 100 plus years ago, and you know, the similar arguments. But bluntly, what you have, and Ronan Fanning's book, The Fatal Path, I think is the best source in this, shows very, very comprehensively how large sections of the British establishment were utterly in sympathy with Ulster Unionist defiance and indeed assisting it in various ways. So it's nice to think that there might have been a happy path to home rule and from there to independence of the United Ireland, but happy ever after is not very strong in history, most of us realise. As for violence, militarisation, well, as Owen McNeill former president of the Royal Irish Academy said, the North began, and the North, the first moves towards military involvement came from Ulster Unionists. You must see Easter 1916 in the context of what was happening in Ireland from 1912 onwards. You have to see it also in the context of World War I. There is a significant wave of militarisation, volunteering, militias happening throughout a large part of Europe during those years. If there hadn't been World War I, 1916 would probably not have happened, or it would have been different. But Ireland might well have had a really nastier civil war between Ulster Unionism and Irish Volunteers. You know, that is where things were heading when the war broke out. Hostility to the Rising has probably been overstated. Many people were bewildered, not necessarily antagonistic. British mishandling of the events was really, really important. You can see why they had to court-martial the leaders. They were executing underage soldiers in the Great Front as deserters at the time. There were 15-year-old boys being executed as for desertion, so to have let the leaders off scot-free would have been impossible. But they executed some people for sheer willful malice almost. John McBride, Willie Pierce, there's several others. James Connolly, who was dying anyway. So the court-martials, the executions, the mass internments, all very, very mishandled and helped swing public opinion in favour of the Rising. Similarly, Lloyd George's trickster attempts to introduce Home Rule in the summer of 1916, where he promised permanent partition to Carson and he told Redmond it would be temporary. And then, of course, you get the threat of conscription. So I think the radicalisation of Ireland is deeply understandable in the light of World War I. A lot of other parts of Europe become very radicalised during those years as well. And 1918, you get the Sinn Féin landslide at the time. But coming back to 1916, it was always seen as the high point in the decade of centenaries. And despite the serious financial crisis in Irish government finances, important capital spending to mark the occasion did start 3 or 4 years ago, in other words, in time to have it completed for 2016. Mm-hmm. So we're getting out of it a new military archive, which may seem very, esoteric to some of you. It's absolutely essential because the army have a wonderful heritage and they are determined and they're so proud of it and preserving it. And the records they hold of military pensions and Bureau of Military History, you can get them online, but for so many people, they want to see them physically as well. And there's much more there. You know, it's a stunning place. It'll be even more stunning when it's finished. And you'll be able to also see the yard where Francis Sheehy Skeffington was and those other people were executed in 1916. There's also a big project, almost complete, I understand, at Kilmainham Courthouse, which is next to the jail. That's where the court martials were held, and that's also done. The Old Richmond Barracks, which is where all the people who were deported to Britain were held after the Rising, before they were deported. New York Times columnist had great fun doing descriptions of it in 1966 because it was being used to house people who'd been rehoused from tenements that collapsed in the city centre. And it was used to really, rubbish the improvements that had taken place in the country at the time. So this is going to be a community project, it's going to be a historical project, and I'm delighted to see it being done. Pierce's Cottage at Rossmuck has also been renovated. And there will be a new interpretive site in the GPO. And more recently, following a lengthy campaign by relatives, part of Moore Street has been incorporated into that. Now, I must say personally, when this Moore Street campaign started first a few years ago, I was on the sceptical side. But having seen presentations by the archaeologists, there is an interesting track that you can follow. It has a lot of potential, I realised. There are also remarkable projects underway in the National Library, the National Museum, the various universities, my own university, UCD, which has a very strong connection to the Rising in terms of participation and wonderful records. We're all putting together a remarkable collection of stuff, archivally, in digital form, that will be accessible to anybody, anywhere in the world, no matter where they are. And I've been pushing for one site on the commemorative website where people can know where to go to get the whole thing. But of these, I think the real gem are the military archives. And this government is genuinely committed to embracing 1916. Last October, the Royal Irish Academy had the privilege of hosting the launch of a biography of W.T. Cosgrove by an Taoiseach Enda Kenny. And Enda Kenny used the occasion very deliberately to, I think, refute some of the John Bruton version of Irish history. And what the Taoiseach said was that W.T. Cosgrove was always proud to be a 1916 man. He saw the Rising as the central formative and defining act in the shaping of modern Ireland. Many of those who were leading figures in the parties he led, Cumann na NGael and Fine Gael, Richard Mackay, Ernest Blythe, Desmond Fitzgerald, Fionnuala Lynch and many others were also 1916 men, and it was the unshakable conviction of Cosgrove and other founders of Cumann na NGael that their party was a 1916 party and drew its inspiration from the memory of 1916. This too was the view of Liam Cosgrove who was there when he led Fine Gael. It's my view and the view of the party that I have the honour to lead today. And then he went on to say, it's important to note that W.T. Cosgrove was neither narrow nor exclusive in his view. He had no difficulty accepting Fianna Fáil's claim to be a 1916 party also. And that's another stage that was mentioned, the Labour Party. That, in a way, was the central tragedy of the split that led to civil war, the sundering of the old Sinn Féin and the terrible consequences for our country. So there is genuine commitment among the main political parties to the event. The official programme came out late, and as a member of the Expert Advisory Committee, we were the people who kept saying, get it out, get it out, get it out. But bluntly, the programme as published, which you can get on the website, is actually very ambitious and comprehensive, and there will be local events because the local really matters. So you're getting themes, ceremonial, a lot of parades, a lot of historical, which I've mentioned, Irish language, cultural, youth, and a special diaspora dimension, which was not explicitly indicated in earlier programmes. What interests me at the moment as somebody who is a historian is how much genuine interest there is in the history of 1916, particularly the histories of ordinary people. Joe Duffy, one of the RT presenters, focused on the children who were killed in 1916. That's got huge, huge popular attention. So you're getting into much more the ordinary men and women story than was got in than we got in 1966. And can I say the military pensions files particular release was the women who were involved in 1916, people like Margaret Skinner and people like that. So we can bring the story beyond Constance Markovitz. The other interesting thing is there's actually less interest than there was in 1966 in futurology, or even linking the commemoration to contemporary Ireland, and I find that a bit puzzling. But all schools are being asked to write a proclamation for Ireland 2016, and there's going to be a special day dedicated to that event, which is going to be interesting. As I said, diaspora is a particular focus, and I know that there's been meetings there, because there is an understanding, and I think it needs to be a two-way process. We need to inform Irish people in Ireland about the involvement of the diaspora. A big missing gap, and I hope you're not offended by my saying this here in New York, really, it's only now that there's a better understanding of the Irish men and women who travelled from Scotland and England to take part. They've never been written into the story. We've always had the Irish American, but they're very, very important. And one of the stories I want to see captured, we should be able to get some from the military pensions files or the Bureau, are those veterans who left Ireland after independence. Because I know in 1991, Ray Flynn, Mayor of Boston, had three 1916 veterans on the viewing stand. There was only one in Dublin at the time. So, you know, I think there's interesting stories there. But there's also the international story, the resonances of 1916 in India, for example. Now, what's still for debate? First of all, I still think the relatives are looming very large, and quite how any official commemorations are going to manage to deal with the thousands and tens of thousands of relatives who may show up, I do not know. But there is a huge hunger for engagement, involvement, particularly from those living outside Ireland. The second red herring that emerged into the whole thing is a question of a royal visit. Now, I'm on record, and I'll say it here, if the German president can go to Belgium to mark the opening of the Great War, if Angela Merkel can go to D-Day landings and be there to mark an Allied invasion, or more recently, if President Higgins can be the guest of the Turkish president at Gallipoli to mark the landing of Irish troops who are invading Turkey, the Ottoman Empire, and fighting against them, we should be open to some royal participation, but not on Easter Sunday, only in the context of an international event where you would possibly invite the Secretary of State, US Secretary of State, the Vice President or something like that, senior dignitaries from Canada, Australia and Europe. The majority of people actually would quite well, would seem to be in favour of a royal visit. I don't think we're going to get one at the moment, but the way we don't, I think it shouldn't be done, is you keep the event domestic rather than international. But if it's international, if you bring in international statesmen, other things open up. The uncertain bit, and it keeps running all the time through it, is the North, of course. There were fears, and I would have held them, that the anniversaries of the founding of the Ulster Volunteers might have ignited trouble. They so far have proved singularly, unproblematic. Commemoration so far has not fueled any increase in tensions in Northern Ireland. But I have some concerns that the Irish government, and I've articulated them, is afraid to look north of the border and that we will have another commemoration that stops at Newry. And on that basis, I have volunteered the Royal Irish Academy, which is an All-Ireland Academy. We still work under the George III Charter because that has protected our All-Ireland status. Otherwise, we would end up in a slightly different way. We have offered our services to organise one or two events, academic events in Northern Ireland, looking at Ulster nationalism and looking at a book of biographies of those who were active throughout political life in Ulster from 1886 to the 1920s, be the unionist, nationalist or something in between. But I do think the Northern Ireland space still needs a little bit of attention. Now, I'm going to conclude, you've been very patient, by simply saying that I've done various interviews about the commemoration. And one question I've been asked more than once is, what would I like to see in the 2016 commemoration? And my one sentence response is that I want to see a grown-up, mature commemoration. And by that I mean, let's acknowledge 1916's centrality in Ireland's history, and indeed the history of Britain and the British Empire. Let's acknowledge that 1916 was a violent act, but then many countries, including the United States of America, were born through violence. Ireland is not unique, it's not pathological as a consequence. There were divisions. There's no need to apologise for it. But ultimately, the story is a very positive one. What you need to bear in mind is that an independent Ireland is now one of the longest surviving and strongest democracies in Europe and indeed in the world. And I think we should be very proud of that. So thank you very much.
Now you see in retrospect why there should have been champagne popping after Mary's lectures in UCD. Oh, and please stay in touch with us on this, because the spirit, very same values that Mary is talking about that apply to Ireland are the same ones that are guiding us here. And I want to pay tribute to the Hibernians and the GAA again for partnering with us tonight as an example of our, what you say, more into the big tent approach, big, wide, happy family approach to all of this. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention.